Hola, buenos días, buenas tardes y buenas noches tal vez a quienes van a participar en este panel. Bienvenidas, bienvenidos y bienvenides todes. Hoy día tenemos un panel realmente interesante, enfocado en derechos humanos. Estaremos con One World, que es un festival de derechos humanos que tiene su sede en República Checa, y Movies That Matter. Que se encuentra en La Haya. Pensamos que un panel como este es muy relevante para los cineastas latinoamericanos que están muy interesados, acostumbrados y cuyas películas versan sobre muchísimos temas de interés en relación con los derechos humanos, ¿no? Con las grandes épicas que están ocurriendo, las grandes tragedias también que están ocurriendo en nuestro continente en relación a los derechos humanos. Así que ya que este es un tema recurrente, esperamos que este panel sea muy fructífero para ustedes, conocer estos festivales, estas instancias de difusión, donde vamos a tener a dos invitados maravillosos, Tomás Postulka, programador del festival One World, y Martin Stoltz, senior programmer del festival Movies That Matter. Para hablar con ellos, para mantener esta conversación que va a durar alrededor de 40 minutos a una hora, tenemos el placer de contar con el director Sebastián Moreno. Él ha dirigido películas sobre derechos humanos, se ha especializado en esta temática, tiene una trilogía muy bella, consistente en la primera película llamada La ciudad de los fotógrafos, que es una película que fue financiada por uno de los fondos más importantes que existen para documentales en el mundo, el ITFA Bertafan. Tiene después una película llamada Habeas Corpus sobre el rol de la Vicaría de la Solidaridad, uno de los organismos que combatieron la dictadura chilena, y Guerrero sobre un importante activista de derechos humanos, hijo de un académico que fue asesinado en dictadura. Todas estas temáticas, como ustedes pueden ver, están enfocadas en derechos humanos, así que Sebastián tiene muchísima experiencia en este tema y esperamos que pueda tener una maravillosa conversación con Tomás y Martín, de quienes estamos muy agradecidos que puedan compartir con nosotros. Tenemos también presentes a Paulina y Camila, ellas son intérpretes en lenguas de señas chilena, nos van a estar acompañando. Esperamos que sea útil para toda la comunidad sorda o con hipoacusia, para que puedan compartir también estos paneles con nosotros. Y por otro lado, tendremos traducción simultánea. Ustedes pueden activar la traducción simultánea. Hay un abajo de su Zoom webinar, hay un mundito. En ese mundito pueden seleccionar el idioma que quieren escuchar, español o inglés. Y pueden así participar de la conversación también a través del chat o a través, si están conectados a través de YouTube o Facebook, a través de los chats también, enviando sus preguntas, sus comentarios, sus felicitaciones también, si quieren hacerlo, a nuestros invitados y también a nuestro moderador. Así que sin más, los dejo a todos con nuestros tres grandes invitados, Martín. Hi, Martin. Thank you
Hello,
for
hello,
being
hi
here.
everybody. Hi.
Thomas. Hi, Thomas.
Hello, everyone.
How is everything going?
I think since I'm here, the best as it gets, actually. It's great.
Thank
It's
you
great
very
to be
much.
here, and it's
Thank
an
you very
honor
much.
to receive an invitation from you.
To both of you, it's the first time for you in Conecta.
Yes,
And
yes.
yeah, so thank you for being here. And also, we have this fantastic moderator, Sebastián Moreno. Hi, Sebastián. Hola, Sebastián.
Hola a todos, muchas gracias por la invitación.
Estamos muy honrados y honradas de que nos acompañes. Esperamos que sea una muy buena conversación. Te dejamos a ti a cargo. hasta el final. ¿Ah? Así que tú puedes dialogar con nuestros invitados, con el público asistente y luego dar cierre al panel. Un millón de gracias por estar aquí los tres.
Muchas gracias, Paula, por esta presentación tan bonita. Gracias por la invitación, además, a moderar este panel tan interesante, con invitados tan interesantes. Los derechos humanos nos unen, ¿no? Los derechos humanos nos conectan. Y creo que nos sorprenden. Creo que hoy tenemos dos invitados súper interesantes a los que quiero hacer algunas preguntas como bien también específicas y técnicas. Y creo que las preguntas que tengo son válidas para los dos. Entonces creo que puede responder uno primero y el otro después, ¿ah? para que sea un diálogo entre los tres. ¿Ok? No es común tener festivales de derechos humanos, no es fácil sostenerlos, digamos. Entonces, la primera pregunta es, de alguna manera, ¿cómo nacen estos festivales y cómo han logrado sostenerse en el tiempo, ¿no? ¿Cómo, desde dónde vienen su origen y cómo han logrado perseverar y lograr seguir existiendo, ¿no? ¿Con qué apoyos? Si son apoyos estatales, son apoyos privados, ¿no es cierto? ¿De dónde surgen? Martin, Thomas, el que quiera.
So I maybe can start with my answer because regarding One World is a very specific kind of origin which is connected to one of the biggest NGOs in the whole Europe, which is called People in Need, who provides humanitarian and human rights aid in countries like on continents like Africa or countries like Belarus, Syria, and these kind of countries where human rights are severely violated. And actually the first edition of One World was in 1997. It was founded exactly with the People in Need organization. And now it has the next year will be the 24th edition of the festival. But obviously People in Need is not the only funding that we are getting. Actually, we are really dependent on, for example, Czech Cinema State Fund and also for other grants and Ministry of Culture of Czech Republic, which are the main sponsors of our festival. Without them, it would be probably impossible to actually maintain the festival throughout these all these years. We are also collaborating with the local embassies from countries which we have most films in the program. For example, every year a lot of films are coming from Denmark, so we collaborate with Danish embassy, Swedish embassy, Italian cultural institute, and all these kind of institutions that are available for funding mm-hmm. in the Czech Republic. So these all are combined. Actually create the budget of our festival and thanks to them, we are able to maintain the festival, hopefully many years from now. So this is for One World.
Super, super. O sea, es un compromiso muy profundo del Estado checo, que está comprometido también, ¿no? Y de todas estas ONGs que soportan. Super, super. Martin, ¿tú tienes alguna...?
Sure. I have to say that my Spanish is very rusty, so you have to translate some of the questions in English. But based on the response from Tomás, I was able to distillate the question. So Movies That Matter started off years ago as the Amnesty International Film Festival. So there were a couple of people in Amnesty International, the Netherlands, who had the idea, we have to do something with film. And they had the idea, let's create a small festival, screen a couple of films and see what happens. That's how it started. It grew over the years. And after a while, the Amnesty International Film Festival, as it was called back then, decided to go a separate way and became their own organization. so they that they were able to get their hands on funds that Amnesty International is not allowed to get. So basically, in a practical sense, Amnesty International cannot take any funds from the government, for instance, because they don't want to have any influence from the politics. Movie That Mattered does wanted to have those funds and work together with them, and also became a film festival on its own. So that's why in 2009, we changed the name to Movies That Matter, and we moved from The Hague, from Amsterdam to The Hague. The move was mainly because in The Hague, or as you in Spanish call it, La Haya, is the city of peace and justice. And that's where all the embassies are, that's where the politicians are, and that's where the International Criminal Court is. So there's a very clear connection between human rights, the Netherlands, and The Hague. So for Movies That Matter to go there made sense. And ever since we did that, we had an amazing growth in audience. So I think the second year we were in The Hague, we already had a growth of 100% of the audience, and it kept growing basically till the pandemic hits. Amnesty International is still a strong partner. They're still one of our main partners, but there's not as much connected as they were in the past. And the other main partner we had for a long time was the Freedom Fund, which is a fund in the Netherlands basically working for war veterans and helping freedom and peace in the world. But they we parted ways a couple of years ago, and now the Postcode Lottery actually stepped in. So now we're partly funded by the lottery as well. So you have Amnesty International and the Postcode Lottery as our main partners. And of course, below that, there are a whole lot of other partners and sponsors who agree with our mission, who agree with our vision, and help us financially or in any other ways. Do you want me to talk a little bit more about Movies That Matter, or do you want to move on?
Sí, sí, no, perfecto, perfecto, perfecto. Era para iniciar. Yo tengo algunas preguntas, pero ustedes obviamente pueden responder lo que quieran y agregar el contenido que quieran, ¿vale? O sea, muy libre. Para los dos, una vez los festivales, ¿cómo funcionan? O sea, ¿qué categorías tienen? Por ejemplo, si tienen categorías dentro de sus selecciones, ¿cuáles son esas categorías, no es cierto? Y los festivales, ¿cuáles son los criterios que tienen para seleccionar una película? ¿Pesa más el tema que está tocando, o pesa más la factura y la forma de contar la historia, no es cierto? ¿Cómo barajan eso, no es cierto? Si pueden alternarse, quizás ahora parte Martin, luego Thomas.
So if I understood correctly, you want to talk about the selection procedure and the requirements for the festival, right? How the festival and how the program comes into place, right? Cool. So for Movies That Matter, if you allow me, I quickly share with you a little screen so I can tell you a little bit more about Movies That Matter in general, because we're more than just a festival. Cool. Let's see if this works.
Super.
Okay, so first of all,
lo vemos.
Do you see it? So first of all, this is me. If you want to reach out, write me an email. Here's my email address. I'll put it in the chat as well. And here, this is basically what Movies That Matter is as a whole. So we're a festival, which is at the end of March, where we screen fiction and documentary. And I'll tell you a little bit more about the requirements and the procedure behind it. But first, I want to tell you that we also have a large education department where we reach out to all the students in the Netherlands and offer them and the teachers in all the classrooms the possibility to screen human rights related films to their topic. So we have specific catalogs, for instance, on the topic of geography or history. And as a teacher, you can go to our website, choose the film, screen the film, and have an in-depth program, basically some tools, some quizzes, some questions and answers for the students to talk about the film. This way we reach around 200,000 students every year. Besides the festival and education, we have an on-tour program which means that Movies That Matter travels all around the Netherlands in 18 cities in the Netherlands, where we screen every month a film in those 18 theaters. And of course, nowadays we do a lot of things online at our own platform, but also with other partners, like, for instance, The Correspondent or The Green Amsterdammer, which are both Dutch journalistic platforms. And we have an international support program. And in this international support program, Movies That Matter supports other human rights related festivals or events in countries where freedom of press is under pressure. So if you have a plan to host a screening event or organize a festival, you can go to our website and you can ask for funds. Twice a year, we organize a call for submission, or you can apply to ask for these funds. In this way, we have supported festivals in China, in Pakistan, in the Gaza, in Colombia, all over the place. Basically around 24 festivals every year. Part of the international support program is also the embassy menu. Every year on the 10th of December, the Day of Human Rights, we basically provide a menu of 5 or 6 titles to all the Dutch embassies worldwide. And they can choose one or choose all of the films to screen on or around the 10th of December in or around the embassies. So in 8 days, this will take place again, and over 50 Dutch embassies will screen those 5 or 6 films. The films from the embassy menu, the films in the tour, the films we screen online, they're all a spin-off of the festival program. So if you're a filmmaker out there, you're listening, if once you're selected for the festival, you will be automatically in the running for the other options as well. I can talk way more about this. I will not, because I want Thomas to have the floor as well. Quickly share one more thing to answer your question about how the process of the festival take place. So if you go to our website, moviesthatmatter.nl, and you go here to the festival, you can see the program here. And because we are a human rights related festival, most of our competitions and themes, they are thematic. So they're basically connected to a human rights or sustainability. So if you look at our programming and look at our competitions, for instance, you see that we have the activist competition, which is 8 documentaries about human rights defenders. And what we do is we screen the film, we invite the human rights defender to go to The Hague, connect them to the audience, and we create a personal impact program for the human rights defender with companies, organizations in the Netherlands who are of interest for them. So for instance, we connect them to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, to Amnesty International, to the International Criminal Court. So here you can see basically the 8 films we had last year. One I would like to point out is 1,000 Cuts, about Maria Ressa, the Nobel Peace Prize winner of this year, together with Dmitry Muratov, who's a Russian journalist. And so all our competitions are basically thematic. So Kamerjustitia is about justice, reconciliation. We have a Dutch competition, and we have 2 grand jury competitions. Well, to round it all up, our themes are the same. We have a theme on future, which is about climate change, sustainability. We have a theme about love, which includes LGBTQI, but also a lot of relationships on macro and micro level. And we have a theme on power struggles on macro and micro level as well. So it could be between countries, but could also be between 2 partners, for instance. So yeah, let me stop there and give Thomas the floor now.
Thank you, Martin. Wonderful presentation. For One World, I would say that we are, unlike Movies That Matter, we are focusing only on documentary, human rights documentaries. But as I understood, you include also fiction films, right? And for us, we are based in Prague, in Czech Republic. We usually take place on March, but last edition we had to postpone it to May because we thought that COVID measures will be weakened by then in Czech Republic, and we were wrong, and we needed to go online anyway. So that didn't help at all, actually. So we are returning back to March for the 2022 edition. last years were tough for like every film festival probably, so we needed also to do some reductions in our program. We used to have up to 130 films in the program, and for the next edition, unfortunately, we will have only 75 to 80 documentaries. But I think that this still gives us a lot of space for a lot of topics to cover. So, and we also, maybe in this way, we can also like raise the bar of quality in the program, because we really need to focus in our programming only for the best of the best. So I think that this can also have like positive outcomes for this reduction. And we are also a traveling festival, so we don't take place only in Prague, but after a Prague part of the festival, we are traveling through regions across the whole Czech Republic. We have 25 regional towns and cities for 2022. And for this edition, this will be one major change because we used to start in Prague, but for 2022, we want to start in the regions because for them, it will be also, these last 2 years were even tougher for them than for us, because they, every city has its own coordinators, which are doing the festival on a voluntary basis completely, which is great for us. But since the Prague was always the first and regions came after, due to COVID, many regions just couldn't take place like at all. So we want to do this step towards them to give them the opportunity to actually start a festival, and we'll see how that actually works. We hope that it will help them a little bit at least. Also important part of our programs is also like educational part, which is done by our program One World in Schools. And we pick like 5 to 10 films which have like a length not longer than 1 hour, and we screen it for schools, which is like very important programming part for us, because we really want to reach out to the students, mainly on high schools. And these 10 films for schools are also a part of our main program of the festival. Other activity that we do is called Get Your Audience, which is also like compliant with the thought of like distributing the films that we have in a program to as many people as possible, and also to people that, for example, don't have the opportunity to travel to the capital and see the films there. That's why we are also going to the regions, and Get Your Audience is actually like alternative distribution program, which actually gives the films from certain films from our program for free to the projectionists all over the Czech Republic, and they can organize alternative screenings, for example, in libraries, in cafes, and all these kind of or site-specific places. So this is another our activity. And also last year, due to COVID, obviously we needed to establish our own VOD platform through which we actually streamed the films and also make them accessible for 2 weeks, like all of them, actually, because I think that, let's say, like the good old programming for the cinemas is not that sufficient for us in online environment. It's really difficult to make people to come in a certain time and watch the documentaries. So I think that this VOD opportunity is better for the online environment. And we want to use this platform, which is called One World Live, not only for next editions, just to like for echoes of the festival, but we also want to create, let's say, this small human right documentaries catalog, and we want to add films there throughout the whole year, like packages of, let's say, 10 films, for example, in after the festival, then at in the late summer, and then again in the winter. So this way we will try to create this kind of small scale VOD platform focused on certain topic, and which we think could be very attractive to our core audience, let's say. Mm-hmm. And when I'm supposed to talk about our program in general, we have 3 competitive sections. We have international competition, which contains, let's say, the most narratively and visually innovative documentaries focused on human rights, and also the newest documentaries. Since we are like, let's say, topic driven festival, we are not that strict when it comes to premieres, but in international competitions we are really trying to have the films at least in like obviously Czech premiere, but if we have like world premiere or European premiere, we are really happy about it every time. And then the second competitive section is called Right to Know, which is not that focused on form of the documentary, but more on the topic. And so we also include more, let's say, journalistic stories and stories of activists, which are maybe not that like visually appealing, but we really want to focus on raising awareness in this competitive section. So we also include, let's say, older films and the films that we think that are about topics that are not that discussed as they should be. And we obviously have Czech competition, which contains all out of best Czech documentaries focused on human rights out of the last year. And all these three competitions contain the 10 films every year. This won't be any reduction in competitive sections because there are always like the most attractive titles here. So we made the reductions mainly in our topic-based sections, which are non-competitive. And we always have like this one topic, which is specific for the whole edition. For 2022, we wanted to go, let's say, a little bit back to the roots, and we will focus on dictatorships, authoritarian regimes, and totalitarian regimes, and mainly on the countries where people in need works, actually. And then we will have also one specific and new section for the next edition, which will be focusing on mental health issues, also a little bit connected to the pandemic situation and what it does to minds of the people when you have to sit for a couple of months at home and not being able to do anything, actually. And then we will have our standard thematic section. So one is called Unearthed, which is focused on environmental issues in general. Let's say one section which is more easygoing and let's say like a drop of positive energy in the ocean of heavy human rights topics. It's called Long Live Life. And this section is focused on, let's say, subcultures, alternative ways of living, even sports documentaries connected to human rights can be included there. So this is kind of a relief for our audience. And we will also, we traditionally had a section called 1-0, which was focused on technological issues. And for the next edition, we want to do it a little bit differently and focus it more on like future scenarios, how, for example, job markets will differ from the past in the next years, how economic is changing in nowadays. So it won't be not just about technology, but in the future possibilities in general. So these are our thematic sections, and we will also maintain our virtual reality section. We should choose 6 projects, virtual reality projects, which are focused on human rights. And this has always been really attractive to the audience. We were actually the first festival in Czech Republic who included virtual reality in its program. So we are happy that we will be able to continue and somehow elaborate it in the next years. So back to you guys.
Super, muchas gracias. Muy interesante, muy amplio, ¿eh? Me sorprende la diversidad, el impacto que tienen en sus regiones. Y ahora, por lo mismo, preguntarles que si existe algún vínculo con América Latina, con qué países, ¿hay algún contacto con la realidad latinoamericana, algún país en específico, si nos pueden contar? Martin,
the question: Thomas? How we are in touch with the film organizations in South Latin America? Is that a question? Thomas, did I understand correctly?
No, es existe alguna conexión, alguna unión. O sea, por ejemplo, ¿hay alguna versión que hagan en Latinoamérica del festival o financian películas en Latinoamérica? ¿O existe alguna comunicación con Latinoamérica?
Right.
Sorry, Martin.
Yeah, I'll quickly tell you about the Human Rights Film Network. One World and Movies That Matter and a lot of other films. Basically, One World and Movies That Matter and a film festival in Geneva are one of the co-founders of the Human Rights Film Network. And this Human Rights Film Network is basically a connection of a whole lot of almost 50 human rights related film festivals around the globe. So in this network, we're connected to all these other human rights related festivals. And there are a couple of festivals in Latin America as well. At the moment, not in Chile, but I know there's one in Peru, for instance, and one in Argentina. And especially the one in Argentina is very active, and we're a lot in touch with them. They've been part of the network for a long time. So there is this network of human rights festivals connected to each other, and also in South and Latin America. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Super.
Yeah, for One World, like the biggest connection with Latin America is actually the fact that people in need is working there and have some aid for instance, for the countries like Cuba or Venezuela. And we also always want to reflect the things that happen in these countries in our program, because it's also in the interest of our organization. And to add something from the perspective of our audience, films from Latin America are super popular in Czech Republic. Like always when we have films from Cuba, we had a beautiful film called Cuban Dancer last year, or Once Upon a Time in Venezuela. And they were really big successes for our festival. They were really popular even amongst the regions. So it's some kind of our something that we really want to look at in our programming structure. And we also want to maintain our program as diverse when it comes to like a geographical sense as possible.
Yeah, just to add, I think there's always been a strong connection between Movies That Matter and probably One World as well with the national film organizations. So we're always in touch with all the national film organizations in South America, Latin America. And there's always a very strong representation of the area at Movies That Matter. Every year we have documentary and fiction about the region at our festival. And same goes for us. Those films always do really well. But that's just because they're really good films. I think the standard of cinema in Latin America is really, really good. Something to be really proud of. And as a programmer, I found that it was very, very pleasing to watch films from your region, as most of them are just very well made.
Yeah, as Martin said, we actually, due to the quality of the films that are coming from Latin America, we are considering like every year to have actually a regional focus on Latin America in general. For the next year, it didn't pass, but maybe 2023 will be an option.
Super, super. Existen secciones dentro de los festivales de industria donde alguien pueda llegar con un proyecto para realizar una película y buscar o encontrar el financiamiento dentro del festival, o que el festival lo ayude a encontrar el financiamiento, ¿no? ¿Comprende?
You're talking about industry and how to finance films? Was that the question?
Yeah. Yes.
So at Movies That Matter, we started up the industry days again. We used to do industry that we didn't do for a couple of years. And now the last 2 years, we're starting up the industry days again. And what we do is we create several workshops on film and impact. So I think in the UK and in the United States, there's a lot more talk on impact of a film. And in the Netherlands, it's sort of starting to. You have this basically new job called impact producer. We have about 7 people in the Netherlands who are an impact producer. It's basically thinking about, okay, which impact can my film have? Where does it need to have impact? Who do I need to go to have impact? Who can help me with it financially, but in other ways? And this is a whole other discussion, which I won't do here, but thinking about impact on your film starts when you're making your film. It's not your film is done and then you start thinking about impact. It starts at the same time you're basically shooting your film. As I said, I'm not going to go into that. But at the industry days at Movies That Matter, we talk about film and impact. And we have the rough cut sessions, of course, where we have several rough cut screenings of films, documentary, and hopefully next edition, also fiction. where we connect the filmmakers with their rough cuts to people in the industry who can help them along financially or in any other way with their film. Unfortunately, the deadline to apply for the rough cut sessions was 2 days ago, but we'll keep doing this every year and it will expand. So if you're a filmmaker out there watching and you wanna take part in the rough cut sessions, please keep track of our website for the 2023 edition. Or if you wanna be an observer for the 2022 edition, just drop me an email and I'll connect you to the coordinator of the industry days. You're more than welcome to join and watch, of course.
Yeah, for One World, we are not doing the industry session by ourselves, but we are lucky enough to be in cooperation with Institute of Documentary Film in Czech Republic, which organizes like every year Eastbook Platform, which is one of the biggest events, like matchmaking events for the filmmakers and sales agents and festival representatives in the whole Europe. So they are actually happening in the same dates as our festival, which is great because it's both based in Prague and we could arrange this cooperation a few years ago. And we are happy to announce that since we are coming back to March, these two events will be again colliding, and they are like Institute of Documentary Films. They are really like professional persons to work with documentary films. Last year, even though we didn't happen in the same dates, they did a little matchmaking for us where they put together fitting projects with sales agents and fitting festivals. And actually there has been a few outcomes that the films from our program actually managed to create some dialogue with specific sales agents and to help them their film moving, actually. So this is for our industry, gratitude to Institute of Documentary Film that we can have this collaboration with them.
I had the honor this year to work closely with the Institute of Documentary Film. And I can honestly say that if you want to have a really great overview of the films from the region of Tomas, then you can go to the Institute of Documentary Film and you will see the best films from the region there. It's really a good, well set up organization. And I think the connection you made there, Tomas, with One World and IDF is really powerful. And yeah, it's a really good, connection.
Yeah, they are working primarily with the films from Eastern and Central Europe. And it's really the best of the best from the region. So definitely get in touch.
Super. ¿Qué rol cumple la televisión de los países europeos? ¿Hay algún vínculo? ¿La televisión exhibe las películas de los festivales? ¿Hay ahí un puente? ¿Existe ese vínculo? ¿Qué nos pueden contar al respecto?
So, Movies That Matter works together with one of the main broadcasters in the Netherlands. And every year during the festival, they screen around 4 or 5 movies that matter on Dutch television, which is of course really good. And we're very happy and very pleased that they screen our films on Dutch television. Mm. But I'm not sure how it is in Chile or in Prague, but human rights related documentaries don't get prime time. Television time. So usually when they're screened on TV, it's very late at night. It's difficult for a broadcaster to put those documentaries on a time that is more accessible for people. But having said that, we have this connection. We screen those films on the Dutch television and we reach quite a lot of people. Hundreds of thousands of people with these screenings. Exactly. That's really good.
Yeah, for Czech Republic and for One World, there is a certain reciprocity in the connection with Czech TV, Czech state TV. I think that they are, for us, a really important source of the films, of their production for our Czech competition, because mainly their focus of their films is really to like bring the topics that are painful for Czech, Czech Republic and present them to the to as many viewers as possible. So we use the films of the production of Czech television in our festival. And on the other hand, for example, from last edition, I think that two films from our program actually managed to get on the Czech television. So there is a certain relationship there, but maybe we could work a little bit more to elaborate it for the next years, because I think that the television is really a great platform to distribute human rights documentaries, because it can reach really wide audience. But as Martin put it, it's really difficult to program them for the television, because you know there's a great competition of private channels, and to compete with their content is really hard for human rights documentaries.
Sí, bueno, les cuento que en Chile hay películas que la televisión ha comprado y no exhibe en relación a temas de derechos humanos. Es un problema muy grave que tenemos en Chile. No tenemos esa fluidez con la televisión, porque casi todos los canales son privados. Están condenados al financiamiento privado de la empresarial, entonces no pueden ser libres en su programación. Como para ir englobando, redondeando, me gustaría que nos dijeran cada uno por qué es importante insistir en hablar de derechos humanos, por qué es importante seguir haciendo películas sobre temáticas de derechos humanos y mostrarlas, que el mundo vea, que los jóvenes vean películas sobre temáticas de derechos humanos en el mundo en general, ¿no? Desde su experiencia personal, ¿por qué?
I would maybe share something from the discussion we had about our, let's say, main topic for the next edition. Like I said, we will be focused on dictatorships, authoritarian regimes. And we felt some kind of urge to bring this topic of severe violations of human rights in the world, to highlight this topic because partly because of the pandemic situation, because we felt that like every nation just like closed in itself and somehow tried to deal like logically with their own problems regarding pandemics and all of these kind of things. But we felt the urge to highlight the fact that there are still other problems in the world than COVID. There are still countries like Afghanistan, Belarus, and even in Europe, Poland and Hungary, where human rights are violated like in the worst possible sense. And that's why we actually chose the topic, because we feel that people should just get out of their boxes, their social bubbles for a while again, and focus on the fact that human rights are something of severe interest, and we should consider them as like vital issue for our society. We need to just see what's going on in the world and maybe trying to find ways how to help. And this is also connected to the importance of our school screenings. We think that it's important to bring these topics to the school children, because somehow it's a great supplement for the education in the first place. And also when you start to reach out to them in the young age, there's a bigger opportunity to actually raise them into the citizens that actually care about what's going on in the world.
Super. Muy bien. Martin, ¿quieres compartir tu impresión personal como sobre el rol de estas películas, ¿no? ¿Por qué continuar insistiendo en hablar de violaciones o de derechos humanos y de derechos en general, ¿no? Hoy como ciudadanos del mundo.
So you want to have a personal story why we use film to talk about human rights? That's the question, right? Okay. So for me, like, information flows have grown so much the past 10 years. Like, there's so much information that we can get our hands on. There's so many ways you can get things you're interested in, but also things you're not interested in at all. But it's also fast and fluid that it's very hard these days to really go into depth, really go into detail on a certain topic. And television is also a fast medium. And I think, you know, internet is super fast medium and they're all very important. They all have their strength, but film is actually a very slow medium. You know, film, it takes about 4 or 5 years, sometimes 10 years to make a good documentary. So something that's a hot topic today, and you start making a film now, you'll have the film in 4 or 5 years time. Of course, there are some filmmakers who can produce a film every year, but that is rare. Most of the documentary makers and fiction is a different story at all. It takes years. But for me, that's a good thing because that means that you can actually talk into more detail and in depth about that what's going on and not it's just, okay, let's talk about this topic for now and tomorrow we'll talk about something else. One of my frustrations of the last few days, for instance, is the lack of information, the lack of things we hear about Afghanistan. Like, Afghanistan was a very hot topic a couple of months ago. Everybody was talking about it. Everybody had something to say about it. And now that it's over, you only hear here and there what's going on, but not as much as a couple of months ago. And a film can actually force you to sit down, watch a film for 90 minutes or 2 hours, and basically contemplate and think about, okay, what have we seen about this film that has been made for the last 5 years? And maybe think you about the larger structures behind it or things that aren't as fast and fluid as the news you get on TV and television or on the internet. And one of the reasons, therefore, is that we're going to do a focus on Afghanistan this year. So we're going to screen films. Usually at the festival, we only screen films from the last 1.5, 2 years, because as a festival, you're a front runner. You want to screen the newest films before they're released on the internet or in the cinemas. But for the Afghanistan topic, it's so urgent and so relevant that we decide, okay, let's just screen one of the few amazing films by or over Afghanistan or by Afghani filmmakers from the last 5 or 10 years to put the spotlight on Afghan cinema, basically, and of course what's happening there. And for me, a film is just the ideal way to get loose of the fast train in real life and really get connected to a topic or to a person and actually build and create some empathy for it.
Just to add to the Afghanistan topic, One World only screens the films that are like 2020 or newer. But even though we are actually considering Afghanistan category as well, because even in last like 2 years, we collected like 5 films, which are really great about the topic. And I think that's a great sign. And I think that we can do a lot of impact by screening those films in the program and just frame it into one specific category. So it's great to see that the films from these countries are actually existing and they are really like maybe not enjoyable to watch, but definitely important to watch.
That's actually a good point you make. Like, I think what we think maybe have to touch upon in this panel is about films and human rights are instantly perceived as, oh, it's all very heavy. Oh, it's very, very serious stuff. And it's very hard to watch. And that's, of course, it's true in a certain way, like we're not a comedy festival. But we do screen comedies. You know, we had a comedy last year because human rights is so much, human rights has this very serious stamp, but it's basically, it's about social issues. It's about climate change. It's about things that happen to you and me every day. And so it's actually super broad. So, and for me, of course, you have the hardcore human rights films at Movies That Matter and at One World, but there are all also these other topics that can be related to issues everybody deals with. Like, as Thomas just said, mental health issues due to the pandemic or otherwise is something everybody knows about. It's not one-on-one relatable to human rights, but if you peel down the layers, you will know that it is related to human rights. And you know, as a programmer, we watch hundreds of human rights related films. So the most common question to a programmer is, how do you cope with that? How do you cope watching so many films which are so hard to watch? And the answer is simple for me, basically. Sometimes you can't, sometimes it is hard, especially in those days where you have to finish the program. But in almost all films, there is hope. You know, if somebody is fighting for human rights, so they have a struggle and they're fighting against someone, they're actually fighting for something good. So that person is actually really hopeful and very inspiring. And I'm not sure about you, Thomas, but I always keep faith in something my first artistic director told me. And he said, let's not worry too much about the films where, about the country, or let me rephrase that. We shouldn't worry as much about the places where these films are being made, but we should worry even more about the places where the films are not being made anymore. Because if there are countries out there where films cannot be made about these topics anymore, then you're in really serious trouble. So if a film is being made about a human rights issue in a country, then of course, you want to change something, but at least they were able to make the film and get it out there. That's always something I keep close to myself.
Yeah, I think that we are also always really happy about, for example, for films from Myanmar or for the films from even Belarus. It's like really difficult to shoot the films that are like against Lukashenko there. And the people that are doing it are in severe danger. And many of them are already emigrated from the country. Many of them are still there and they actually face the threat of prison or worse. So it's always, on the one hand, it's fantastic to have these films. On the other hand, there is the question about like, how do you actually make them? How do you actually fund them and release them to the world? And that's why we actually became the part of the International Coalition of Filmmakers in Risk, which is brand new, and we actually are considering to have a panel on this topic, because we will have the honor to bring Alexei Paluyan, which is director of the film Courage, which was about Belarus Free Theater, and he will be part of our international competition jury. And this could be one panelist that we want to have in the next One World edition. So I think that it's important to talk about the position of the filmmaker in these countries, because I think that they are doing a really great and dangerous job. Mm. And we should instantly highlight primarily their work, which we are basically just reflecting.
Right? Mm. Sí, muy interesante. Perdona, Alexis Palma, ¿de qué país es este director?
He's from Belarus, but right now he's in Germany, so he's safe.
Súper interesante.
It's an important topic you touch upon, Thomas, because, you know, especially what you said, like Belarus, Myanmar, but also Venezuela, for instance, it's really hard to make a film there. So if a film does get out of the country, Movies That Matter and One World are one of the platforms that acknowledge the fact that it's almost impossible to make a film there. And we're here to give that platform to a film from these countries. So for instance, you had Está Todo Bien, which was about Venezuela, I think about 3 years ago. Very hard film to make. You know, it was made in the streets of Venezuela about the situation there, about so many people leaving, about doctors not being able to do their job. Very hard film to make. And Movies That Matter and One World are there to give a platform to these filmmakers that risk everything to get the story out. The story that might be picked up by other media as well, but only, as I said, only for a short period of time, or not at all. And we are here to give them the platform and screen the film and talk about what's going on there. And that's where a human rights festival is a little bit different than a regular film festival, as we focus very much on the topic and on what's happening around the world and on human rights, of course, and maybe a little bit less on the filmmaking process. And that dribbles all the way down in the programming, of course. If a film comes from Belarus, you look different with different eyes from than from a film from France, for instance, because from Belarus only two films, well, every 2 years. So this year's a little bit more. I don't know why, but last 5 years there were only like five or six films from Belarus. So yeah, if a film comes out, you take a very focused and proper look at it, definitely.
And I think there's also a little prejudice where when it comes to human rights film festivals that we are like actually put the topic like in front of the, let's say, filmic quality. But I think that the like difficulty and the magic of the job of programming such festivals is find a compromise between two of them, because there are so many beautiful human rights documentaries, for instance. Like our international competition last year was won by the film This Rain Will Never Stop, which was about a Syrian refugee in Ukraine. It was all made in black and white, and it was really a filmic experience in the big screen. So I think that there is definitely a way how to be a human rights festival, but at the same time, screen really great films.
You're absolutely right. That's exactly what it is. As a programmer, it's a lifetime struggle of content and form and how to combine those two. The thing is, you can have the most important topic in the world, but if it's a bad film, it will not work. Not for me, not for Thomas, but definitely not for the audience. So it's a fine line. And I've had three artistic directors at Movies That Matter so far, and everybody has a little bit of a different line, but the discussion is always the same. It's about topic versus form. And that's what makes it interesting. But and sometimes you balance a little bit more towards topic, sometimes you go a little bit more towards form. But I stick to what I said. If you have the most important topic in the world, but it's not made in a proper way, it's not gonna achieve what you want. So be aware of the product you have.
Yeah, it can actually be a counterproductive. Yes. If you screen the film that's super important, but it's really bad, you know, then audience will just react in the exactly opposite way that you want them to react. They get, you know, apathetic a little bit, and they don't want to actually be on the discussion after the film because they are so like tired from what they saw that they just want to leave and not to think about the problematic anymore. So it's really, I think that it's important to think that way, to like find films which are combining important topics and the form that is somehow attractive to the audience.
Sí. Bueno, ahí se abre una pregunta muy importante, creo, que es con cuánta belleza se puede mostrar el horror, con cuánta decoración o lenguaje se puede mostrar el horror, ¿no? Ahí hay una dialéctica, una contradicción, quizás, pero es importante hacer que una historia sea digerible, que el espectador pueda entrar en un viaje, y ahí las herramientas narrativas que se elijan son fundamentales, ¿no? Para ir cerrando, porque estamos un poco en los tiempos, me gustaría que cada uno pueda transmitir a los jóvenes directores latinoamericanos, chilenos, hay muchos, algún mensaje, alguna idea, fuerza, motivación que puedan transmitirle a los jóvenes cineastas chilenos. Y latinoamericano. Esta grabación la van a ver posteriormente, a pesar de que ahora no tenemos muchos espectadores, posteriormente más gente ve esta grabación. Entonces les pido que envíen cada uno un mensaje a los jóvenes.
I would say to them probably, you're doing a great job. Documentary human rights connection is super important, and the most important thing I thing they should know is the fact that there is definitely a platform for your films. It's not only us, like Martin has said, there's the whole Human Rights Festivals network all around the world. And we are looking forward to your films and we will be excited to have them in the festival.
Yeah, I can just acknowledge what Thomas just said. Like as a filmmaker, especially a film, I'm not a filmmaker, I'm a programmer, but based on my conversations with filmmakers, as a filmmaker, especially a filmmaker on human rights, you can feel very lonely sometimes. You know, you make a film about a topic that's very important, but you are doing it and you need help and you probably have a team, but yeah, there's a lot of forces against you maybe as well. Only thing I can say is that there's this whole big international community of the film industry who can help you in any way possible. So it's not a local thing. It's not a national thing. It's an international thing. And there are a lot of people maybe not making films on the same topic, but they're in the same boat, basically. They're doing the same thing. And there are a lot of people out there who can help you in any other way. Like as Thomas said, you now have this Filmmakers at Risk organization. It's actually the International Coalition for Filmmakers at Risk, who can actually help you as a filmmaker to be safe and protect yourself by doing something good, making a film about human rights. So try to reach out to the international community through us, through other ways, and who can help you and support you with what you're doing, because it's so important that these films are being made. You know, we're talking about the shrinking space for human rights. Human rights are very much under pressure right now, way more than 10 years ago. So it's more important than ever that the Chilean filmmakers keep making those films and keep getting them out there. Having said that, there are a lot of films being made, so you do have to think about how am I going to get my film out there? That's an important question you have to answer as well. Just making the film in itself is not enough, because there are a lot of films out there, not only human rights related, of course, but please think about your distribution strategy, your impact strategy, and how you can get to the audience you want to get to.
Super, super. Quiero abrir el panel a los participantes que nos están escuchando, si es que hay alguna pregunta que quieran aprovechar de hacerle a nuestros invitados, este es el momento. Pueden hacerlo a través del chat. Aquí está. No tenemos preguntas, dicen desde Conecta. Ok, muchas gracias. Bueno, yo quiero agradecerles en nombre de Conecta a Thomas y a Martin por haber participado en este panel. No sé si quieran agregar algo más para cerrar, pero yo siento que hemos profundizado bastante. Siempre hay temas que pueden quedar fuera, pero creo que estas conversaciones siempre estimulan seguir haciendo y visibilizando el tema de los derechos humanos en el mundo. Así que, por mi parte, les agradezco mucho, un honor por haber sido el moderador de esta conversación, ¿vale? Espero seguir en contacto, verlos pronto, conocerlos, que la pandemia nos permita reunirnos en algún momento. Muchísimas gracias a los dos, gracias al equipo Conecta por generar este espacio, y eso, no tengo más palabras.
Thank you for having us. It was a pleasure.
Thank you so much. Really enjoyed it. Thank you.
Gracias a los dos. Continuamos. Bye. Thank you. Thank you. Bye, Martin. Bye, Thomas.